Through these and other course specific activities, Mr. Griffith has made learning a truly holistic experience for the students of Crestwood. Mr. Griffith majored in English for Houston Davis, where he also played linebacker for the Aggies football team. After college, Mr. Griffith lived in Italy, Alaska, and Montana before moving to Los Angeles to earn his master's degree in philosophy from LMU, where he stayed on to teach philosophy and critical thinking. In addition to his love for literature and philosophy, Mr. Griffith has a passion for songwriting and playing the guitar. You may have seen some of his performances with fellow faculty members, Mr. Swain, in the short-lived group Parent Notification. Or more recently, perform with his brother Phil at the talent show with Loquacious G. And of course, I would be remiss if I left out that Mr. Griffith is an ardent 49ers fan. We all know Mr. Griffith's love and more about teams than anything, but I think the students can attest to his knowledge for Niners more, and maybe even use this to derail some lessons. Regardless of Mr. Griffith's visible line of allegiance to Bay Area teams, it is clear that Mr. Griffith has lived up to the school's mission of building a community that listens and bears witness to the divine plan through the promotion of justice and the service of the whole person. It is my great pleasure to introduce this year's baccalaureate speaker, Mr. David Ober.
Where are you going this year?
What college did you decide on?
What major did you quit?
What frat are you in? What degree are you in?
Such questions mark the commencement of an interrogation that will continue throughout your life. The subtext of which is the equation of your identity with your destination. There's no doubt that I'm proud of and thrilled by your plans for the future. You're surely one of the most creative, intelligent, and spirited classes Crestwood has known. But tonight I'd like to remind you of something you've shown me time and again these last 4 years at Crestwood. As important as where you go is how you get there. So tonight I won't exhort you on the state of the economy, the academy, politics, the environment, all the very real responsibilities that await you out there. I mean, somebody's going to have to figure this dark matter thing out, Ricky. Rather than speculating about my destination, I'd like to look back at some of my memories over these past 4 years. This happened here, despite the sadistic pleasure of drive drowning you in scantron bubbles, the massive amount of mustard for ready and visiting stacks of tiny essays. Rather than memories of you hard at work, I'm struck most by memories of you at play. The thing about play is that when you're really doing it, no matter where you are, you find that you've already arrived. Your decision of where to go next year, from CSUN to San Diego, from New York to Edinburgh, or from art schools to nuclear submarines, is not trivial. But from what I've seen, you are at your best, most joyful, most disciplined, most bold, most humble, most engaged, most wondering, most compassionate, most Crestwood, when you are at play. First and foremost, we think of play as fun. Crestwood's pencil-studded ceilings, pop-up backpacks, red dog hallways, and later tonight, Magic Mountain's Tatsu Goliath will attest that you have a firm handle on the concept of fun. But you've also shown an appreciation of play that goes beyond your fun, what you might call enjoyment. This deeper potential of play is connected to the word leisure. Believe it or not, the classic Greek word for leisure was skola, which is where we get our word for school. I don't think this is authorization from Aristotle for next fall's polo party. Rather, the ancients recognized that school is a place to go beyond the fleeting pleasures of the hedonistic treadmill, and it's the realm of self-expansion, growth, joy. And it's then my privilege to witness your immersion in this deeper sense of play. Throughout these 4 years, I've watched your play create order out of chaos. From ping pong matches at lunch, to double moves on the field, crossovers on the court, teams and scintillating soliloquies. You joined groups that enabled you to explore your talents and display your skills. When it did not already exist in the Slam Poetry Club and How Art magazine, you found it. Now some insist that traditions are stifling and rituals are chronically out of touch. You demonstrate that without them, improvisation, virtuosity, and individuality become meaningless. In so doing, you carry the torch of self-players before you, and it kindled new lights for those following your path. To some extent, you're leaving such a vibrant legacy because you develop the ability to forget your ego in order to become part of something bigger than yourself. You didn't threaten to bring your ball home when things didn't go your way. Real play is self-aggrandizing, but at the same time is both self-expanding and self-effacing. This quality is perhaps captured less by a crowd surfing at Coachella than by your founding of an august institution that will surely be a part of the school for generations to come, the Crusty Cabana. And tireless support of your athletic brethren, who have themselves sensed that personal statistics for the good of the team, you show that true play requires humility and so defies what for most would result in humiliation. You stop the convention and mockery of opponents and the prevailing wisdom of fashion in order to show solidarity with the Crusty Bugs while wearing white thin shirts and doing the harmless shake. Thus, in the context of the Crusty Brotherhood, you rose to the demands of the play, attaining an exclusive focus of the present moment. Neither self-conscious nor fearful, exhibitions nor reckless. And those of you who had my class have no doubt come to expect gratuitous references to the San Francisco 49ers. So to illustrate the point, I'll take one final moment. It was 1989 Super Bowl against the Cincinnati Bengals. The Niners were down by 3 points with 3:20 left, and Montana spotted, no, not Jerry Rice, not coverage, or Roger Craig in the flat. There in the stands, standing in the exit ramp, Montana looked up to his teammates in the huddle. And Cashman pointed out, is that John Candy? Many of the 49ers 92 yards, throwing for the winning touchdown with 34 seconds left. Yes, you may pride yourself on taking notes, Googling research, browsing Spotify, surfing Netflix, and heeding the call of duty on World of Halo Craft, and simultaneously updating your Facebook with your latest trademark, texting, and Snapchatting, all while feigning attentiveness to Mr. Padilla's lecture on both sides of the world. Don't kid yourself, gentlemen. You know exactly what you're doing at all. You may have become magicians and multitasking, but time can make you also abandon egos and focus like sharks with laser beams in their heads on the task at hand. We've read your writing, seen your films, rejoiced in your songs, and left the stage with your victories. We've seen what you're capable of when you relax and focus, when you really play. Another hero, like John Muir's favorite pastime, was to wait for a thunderstorm, climb the tallest tree in the forest, and hang on for the ride. I've seen you simulate the man most out of your play and out of yourself, because anything less would have been, well, boring. On the ESRL expeditions, I've watched you challenge yourself, return to Crespi, battered, blistered, muddy, bloody, always funky, with harrowing yarns to spin for the city folk, with the assurance that anything less challenging would have been worth the time. Maybe sometimes you were contentious to camp out in English class in a tent. But I've also seen you dodge lightning and ford flash floods in the desert wilderness, complete interminable night hikes over the backbone trail before kayak rescues and get rescued off the coast of Catalina. You even break the Pacific Crest Trail alone after receiving air directions from Google Maps. You should look back with pride and forward confidence because you display like adventurers in the most daunting adversity and learn that without risk and challenge, there is no limit. Okay, so you know how to play. Final story then about what you should play and why play at all. His novel Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, Robert Person described a college professor as dismayed by students who inevitably failed to attend class, to submit work, and who eventually flunked the course and were expelled. Frustrated one semester, he experimented with not reporting grades to students over the course of the year. The work was assessed and feedback was given numeric or letter-bearing. The teacher found that the performance of most of the students either remained the same or improved, except for the failing students who were the source of his exasperation They simply stopped coming to school altogether. These students' motivation for school was wholly external, nothing more than a red mark on a piece of paper or a stamp on their home. When they stopped receiving these inducements, they saw no reason to continue attending. A person wonders, what happens to the dropouts? Imagine if one of them gets a job in an auto shop. After several years of working and developing a passion for his craft, one day he has a question about auto mechanics. Now, as the result of an order from the boss or a client request, the ball, so to speak, suddenly comes to light. He just wants to know. In fact, the dropout mechanic can't get the question out of his head, and after performing his own experiments in the shop, he's compelled to re-enroll in school in order to get help in pursuing his question. Back in school, he demands to sit in the front row, full straight A's, is the first protest that his professor shows any sign of slacking. I like this story because it then underscores the union of wonder and emotional intelligence that is the root of education and is at the heart of real play. As the mathematician and philosopher Blaise Pascal put it, the heart has its reasons of which reason knows nothing. If you mindfully nurture your deepest questions, you'll find yourself thinking about them all the time. It is these questions and not the information crammed into weighty textbooks that will guide you to an ever-deepening knowledge of yourself and to the true realm of kairos, time set apart from the workaday world. Of goals connected with no material interest and from which no profit can be gained, save the joy of engaging in activity for its own sake. Trust your questions. For make no mistake, they are calling you to a place, as the theologian Frederick Beekner puts it, where your deep gladness meets the world's deep need. Trust your questions. You don't know what to play. And as we've seen, learning how to do that. So, to return to the original line of inquiry, where are you going next year? What college did you decide? What major did you declare? What frat are you rushing? Where are you interning? These questions themselves foreshadow the unavoidable salutation of adults that occasion social and business alike. That is, what do you do? For those of you intransigent enough to choose majors and humanities, I warn you from experience, and especially prepared to field parallel questions from well-intentioned but mystified family and peers. English teacher, huh? What are you going to do with that? If you tell them you're studying philosophy, simply anticipate looks of pity and fumble. In such situations, it is with some disappointment that I cannot confide that I, Indian leg wrestle polar bears, that I am fluent in all languages, including three that only I speak, that I have won a lifetime achievement award twice, or that my beard alone has experienced more than lesser man's entire body. But I do try to remember to respond simply and honestly that I teach and that I'm fed. And it is my sincerest wish that you, gentlemen, Professor Carmel High School's graduating class 2013 will continue to do the same. Congratulations.
Counselors haven't been converted and amended to a robust point.
14 years. And nights like tonight are really the paycheck. You get to work with really wonderful kids all year long, and you get to tonight. And there are rewards for all of the efforts. And I'm really grateful for the opportunity to be here to make the presentation that I'm going to make tonight. In 1900, the author, Augustus Buell, rendered his perception of Captain John Paul Jones's views of the qualities necessary in a naval officer. Bear in mind, John Paul Jones never said these words. It is by no means enough that an officer of the Navy should be a capable mariner. He must be that, of course, but also a great deal more. He should be as well a gentleman of liberal education, refined manners, punctilious courtesy, and the nicest sense of personal honor. Patrick, will you join me?
Members of this academic honor society will receive blue and gold awards. awards to the morning graduation. Kaveh Azarush. Nicholas Burke. County. Taylor Hammerich. William Lynch. Nicholas Martinez. Dorian Mendoza Ferroqui. Noah Miller. Joseph Sam. Mark Sasaki. Matthew Samoja. Zachary Thomas. Paul Burkham. Brian Miner. Richard Wolf. And Alan Coyle.
Encourage dedication to the pursuit of scientific knowledge that benefits all humankind. Members of this society receive green, yellow, and purple honor cards. Kabe Azarush. Oliver Bloom. Nicholas Berger. Gabriel Colby. Cody Cordell. Adam Cushman. Raymond Davis. Taylor Hammerich. Connor Hayward. Corey Lutz. Nicholas Martinez.
KENO is the Environmental Studies and Outdoor Leadership Program. Under the leadership of Mr. Griffith, this campus became a popular multidisciplinary program and an important one for students interested in ecology, the sciences, and general environmental awareness. I'd ask that Mr. Griffith come forward as we honor seniors who successfully completed all the requirements of the program. The first set of students will receive green cards. certificate and received honors recognition on her transfer for completing the sequence. Carla McCall. Sean Cole. Stephen Hutchinson.
Tyler.
Martinez. Brian Nansen. the outstanding academic excellence certificates. Donald Dr. Dean. Christopher Cortez Adams. Tyler Cushman. Hayden Day. Marxism. Masaki.
Thank you.
themselves appropriately. Lastly, parents, you can please assist with this last request, but the attire for tomorrow is still shirt and tie. Please be clean shaven. You guys dress up nicely and look great. Your arrival requests will be about 4 p.m. If you are improperly dressed, you'll be sent home to change. The ceremony begins at 5 p.m. with or without you. Reception in the quad after the ceremony is in the quad area next to the gym, between the gym and the main building. The Parent Association has done an outstanding job of trying to make this a very special event. And they request that you enter the reception from the main campus entrance. Do not enter the reception by the white gate. Enter by the main entrance by the school. Thank you guys so much for a wonderful activity.